They're a long way up there, Jim.
Yeah, it is indeed. I just want to start again by commending Minister McEntee and wishing her well in the years ahead, and I wish her every success as Minister for Justice. There are very many provisions in the bill that we're discussing this evening, Cathaoirleach, which are urgent and which are necessary in light of the COVID pandemic. In particular, I think of the repeal of Section 33 of the Prisons Act 2007. That Act provides and requires that a prisoner, when he's been arraigned or when he's been sentenced, he must be physically present in the court. Obviously, in the context of the COVID pandemic, that is an unnecessary requirement, but it wasn't a requirement that could be got around because of the law as it existed. So I welcome the fact that that section is being repealed, and I welcome the fact of the new provisions which are put in place in respect of criminal trials and doing away with the necessity of persons having to be in court in certain scenarios. Obviously, it's preferable if people can be there, but in the context of a pandemic, I think it's important that we preserve and protect the safety, in particular, of our prisons, which have done very well during the course of the pandemic. There are, however, other provisions in the bill which aren't urgent and which I believe would merit further discussion and debate and indeed committee hearing, as was done at the committees of the Justice Committee on previous occasions. And in particular, I'm talking about the provision in respect of the admissibility of business documents. I'll talk about that presently. Can I just in the first instance, however, Cathaoirleach, refer to the provisions in the bill other than the ones I've already mentioned, which are particularly urgent. Chapter 2 of Part 3 deals with remote hearings of civil proceedings. And I'm pleased to say that the courts have already been having remote hearings of cases. That's been happening with the Supreme Court, the Court of Appeal, and indeed the High Court. I assume it's also happening in respect of the courts of local and limited jurisdiction. I think it's important to point out, however, that simply because there wasn't a statutory provision in place at the time when those remote hearings were taking place, that doesn't mean that there's any question mark over them. The High Court is a court of full original jurisdiction. It's entitled to govern its own affairs and to have its own rules in respect of how it's going to conduct its hearings. Very properly, that court determined that the justice system in this country couldn't simply stop because of a pandemic, and because of that, the hearings in the High Court and in the Court of Appeal and in the Supreme Court continued during the pandemic. I want to commend the Presidents of the Courts and the Chief Justice for ensuring that business did continue at a very difficult time for all concerned. The next provision I wish to refer to is in Chapter 3 of Part 3, which deals with business records in documents which are presumed to be admissible in hearings. A number of deputies have spoken about how this is a provision which is put in place to benefit what's referred to as vulture funds. It's unquestionably the case that the provenance of this provision derives from a number of judgments of the High Court, the Court of Appeal, and the Superior Courts, which have ruled on a number of occasions that evidence which has been put before them by certain financial institutions is not admissible because it violates the hearsay rule. In particular, that happens where financial institutions come before the courts having had loans assigned to them, and they try then to put forward evidence on the basis that this is first-hand evidence, which it clearly isn't, because it is information that they have learned as a result of the assignment of the loan. I think it's important to note, however, that this issue of the inadmissibility of certain documents in these proceedings is an issue that has been dealt with by the courts for a number of years. It was referred to by Mr. Justice O'Donnell in the Bank of Scotland case against Beeds. It was referred to by Mr. Justice Barnaville in the case of Promontoria against Burke. And very recently, it was identified by Ms. Justice Baker and Mr. Justice Collins in the case of Promontoria against Burns. I think it's instructive to note, however, Cathaoirleach, that that decision of Burns that the Minister referred to, that was a decision that was only given by the Court of Appeal in April of this year. It was a decision given remotely because of the pandemic. And at the end of it, it was Mr. Justice Collins who referred to the fact that at some stage, when circumstances permit, this is clearly an issue that deserves the attention of the legislature. Now, I have to say, even he, I suspect, would be surprised that the legislature was planning to completely change the law in this area within a period of 4 months. So I don't think we can simply state that there is an urgency to this that requires it to be dealt with this evening. It was referred to in the 2017 report of the Law Reform Commission. However, that report was an enormous report that dealt with reforming the laws of evidence in general. And I think just to selectively pick out one provision within that report and to say we have to run with that now is, I think, doing a disservice to the excellent work that was done by the Law Reform Commission. Look, I would have thought it would be preferable if this very significant change to our law could have been examined and appraised and discussed at a lengthy hearing of the Justice Committee. And I think it's important to point out to other deputies here, although deputies keep talking about how this is for the benefit of what's referred to as vulture funds, this is a provision in the law that will have a significant impact and it will apply to a whole variety of business disputes. I suppose the core of the provision is contained within Section 13, which says that in civil proceedings, any record in a document form compiled in the ordinary course of business shall be presumed to be admissible as evidence of the truth of the fact or facts asserted in such a document. That's a significant change to the law. Generally, when a document is produced in a court of law, that document is only evidenced or proven if an individual comes before the court and says, yeah, I generated that document, or this is a document I received. It's never the case that the information and content contained within the document is regarded as proof of the facts contained within the document. That is a presumption that this section is now inserting into our law. Now, like all presumptions, it's a rebuttable presumption, and subsequent provisions provide for that. But I would have thought that this provision would have benefited from it expressly stating that it is a rebuttable presumption. And I would have thought we need to be careful in terms of how we enact legislation like this, which could have consequences beyond which all of us intend here. So, listen, I will vote for it. I'm a member of the government. But I would have thought a provision like this, which is not urgent, and which clearly is something that has been discussed in the courts and was being the subject of a Law Reform Commission report, it clearly would benefit from more consideration, particularly by the Justice Committee. There are then further provisions in the legislation dealing with that, and they take us up to part four of the bill, which deals with the criminal procedure. I've mentioned that briefly already, Ciarán Corla, and I think it is a benefit that we are repealing Section 33 of the Prisons Act 2007. Then we have miscellaneous provisions, and one in particular that stood out is this issue in respect of statements of truth. I think it is unfair that for very many years, people who do not have a religious belief felt that they were compelled to swear on a Bible that the evidence they were about to give is truthful. I know it was the case that individuals always had the option of affirming, but the affirmation process is more complicated than people actually believe it to be at present. So I think we need to recognise that we need to accommodate individuals who do not share the beliefs that many of us do, but who want to be able to be part of the justice process. I also would just like to point out, finally, in respect of the provisions I've referred to in Chapter 3 of Part 3, the explanatory memorandum refers to the fact that this admissibility of business documents is something that will apply in criminal proceedings as well. The bill doesn't provide for that. It's only in respect of civil proceedings. However, it is the case that in our criminal law, as the courts have recognised, that we have relaxed the rules in respect of the admissibility of certain documentation in order to enable those documents to be admitted as evidence and not to fall foul of the hearsay rule. I think it's also important to note, and we can be comforted by this, that no matter what is in a piece of legislation that we enact here, that when these issues get to be dealt with in any court, we have an independent judge who's going to appraise the evidence. Just because a document is admissible in evidence doesn't mean it is going to be accepted by the court as being proof of what's contained within it, or that the court is going to accept the veracity of the person putting forward that document. courts will always continue to assess cases in the civil field on the basis of the evidence that is given, and no statutory provision that we create here this evening is going to undermine that, Cathaoirleach.